So, in this video, we are going to discuss the concept of injunctions. What are injunctions? You must have come across this term if you are practicing. Injunctions are orders by the court which either restrain the party from doing an act, or under which a party or a person is being asked to perform an act that is directory in nature. So, injunction are those orders which may restrain a party from doing an act or which direct the parties to perform an act. All right. If it restrains a party from doing an act, here it means the party is asked to omit something from doing which he otherwise would have done. So this is the negative aspect. Directory means the party is being asked to perform something, to do an act. Positive aspect of injunction. All right. Now, what is the cause of action of injunction? Why would a person apply for injunction? For this, we have to understand, in order to know this, we have to understand the origin of injunction. See, most of our statutory law, it is borrowed from the common law. Be it Indian Contract Act, be it Partnership Act, it is borrowed from the common law. Common law means the law which arose in England in form of precedents. Common law was never legislated by the Parliament of England. There were common law courts in England which gave certain judgments and precedents on the basis of which certain principles got crystallized, which we call common law. Now, under common law, there was one basic principle relating to cause of action that your complaint, your application, or your petition shall be admissible in the court of law only if you have suffered some loss or you have suffered some damage. All right. Till the time you have not suffered any loss or damage under the contract law or under the torts law, or under any other law, your plaint, your proceeding is not maintainable in court of law. So first, you must have suffered any loss or damage. See, these were two rigid principles. Because ultimately, these principles were defeating the purpose of law. The basic object of law should be to save the party from loss. But here, common law asks that first loss should be there, only then I am going to compensate you. Instead of saving the party from loss, the common law, it rested on this premise that there has to be some loss first. So, a need was felt to have some parallel courts which were not bound by the principles of common law. These courts are known as chancery courts. Chancery courts. Now, chancery court system was parallel to the common law system. They did not adhere to the precedents of common law courts. Rather, they created their own principles, which we know as equity. So the judgments delivered by the chancery courts, the principles contained in those judgments is known as equity. Now, they devised one equitable principle, which was that preemptive relief is permissible under equity. See, a preemptive relief is that relief which a person takes from the court because he fears that he is going to suffer any loss. Though loss might not have yet occurred to him, he might not have suffered any damage, but still he can file a complaint or an application before the court. If his fear is justifiable, if his fear is reasonable, that his right is going to get violated and some person is going to get violate his right. In such an event, preemptive relief can be given by the court to protect the right of this person, to save him from loss. An injunction was one of such concept. We have injunction in Specific Relief Act. Specific Relief Act is the substantive law relating to injunction. And whole of Specific Relief Act is based upon equitable reliefs. That is, there were certain reliefs which were created, which were devised by chancery courts in form of equity, and those reliefs were borrowed and put in Specific Relief Act. And injunction is one of such relief. Injunction is based upon doctrine of quatimit means one who fears. So if a person is having justifiable or reasonable fear that the defendant is going to violate his legal right by doing breach of an obligation. See, if a person is having a right, this right will be there. We can call that he has a vested right only if there is a corresponding obligation with respect to that right. So one's right is other person's obligation. Here he is having fear that his right is going to be violated because other person is going to breach his duty, other person is going to breach his obligation. In that event, court may issue injunction restricting that party from committing the breach of obligation. This is injunction. So injunction is a judicial order by the court asking a party to do an act or to refrain from doing an act in order to prevent breach of an obligation in favor of a plaintiff or an applicant. All right. So this was the origin of injunction. Now let us have an example here. It shall be easy to understand it now. A, he is a tenant. All right. He has certain land over. He is in possession of certain land on the basis of lease, which he has agreed, entered into with B, a landlord. B, a landlord. Now, if B comes over to A and threatens him that he is going to dispossess him, that he is going to throw out his luggage, he is going to throw out his belongings from his house. Now, this person, he, as he is a tenant, now he is having a reasonable fear that his right is going to get violated because B is going to breach his obligation. Here, A can file a suit for injunction, injuncting B from dispossessing A. Another example can be taken where A and B are parties to a suit, the subject matter of which is a property. Now, this is a disputed property, and dispute is regarding ownership and possession, and same are the issues before the court. Now, if A has the fear that B is in possession of the land, that since B is in the possession of the land, therefore he is going to damage this property, or he is going to sell this property, alienate this property to someone else, A can file an application of temporary injunction in the same suit. Pending before the court, he can, in the same suit, he can file an application of temporary injunction. All right. So these were two examples of injunction. Now you have, now you know the origin of injunction and what does it actually mean. Let us go deeper into injunction. I have told you that SRA is the law, substantive law regarding injunction. We shall study the bare provisions of SRA, but let's have a look at the kinds of injunction. So, on the basis of time, injunctions can be classified into two categories. The first is temporary injunction, and the other is permanent injunction. We shall come to the bare provisions relating to these type of injunctions later. Let us first examine the difference between the two. The first point of difference between them is the temporary injunctions, it remains in operation only during pendency of the suit. See, a temporary injunction cannot be filed independently. A temporary injunction is always filed by way of an application, which has to be filed in a suit only. That is why it remains in operation only during the pendency of the suit. Or the court might have specified some time in the order itself, 1 month, 2 months, or as per the order. So, it remains in operation during pendency of the suit generally, or the time limit might further be constrained by the court itself. However, permanent injunction, it remains in operation perpetually. Remains in operation perpetually. That is why sometimes permanent injunction is known as perpetual injunction. Perpetual injunction. Perpetual means forever. The second point of difference I have already told you, that a temporary injunction, it is filed by way of application. While a permanent injunction, it is filed by way of suit. A suit is filed. All right. The third point of difference is that this application shall culminate in form of an order. So temporary injunction is granted by way of an order, while perpetual injunction is granted by way of decree only after appraising evidence, only after appreciating evidence on merits. So, the next point of difference would be standard of proof. See, in case of perpetual injunction, since it is a suit, so standard of proof in case of civil suit is applicable here. The same standard has to be followed, which is preponderance of probabilities. Preponderance of probabilities means the court shall, it shall, after appreciating evidence of both the parties, it shall measure the probability of plaintiff's case and defendant's case. Whose probability is more, that party is going to get decree in its favor. Unlike in criminal cases where prosecution has to prove the proof has to prove the guilt of the accused beyond reasonable doubt. Here, the comparative analysis is made by the court. And whose probability of the case is more, whose probability of proof is more, the court shall award decree to that party. But in case of application, temporary injunction application, since it is not a suit, and this power to grant temporary injunction is a discretionary power, there are certain principles made by the court, Supreme Court itself, which check this discretionary power. This temporary injunction is granted by way of discretion by the court. And to check this discretionary power, there are three major principles. Prima facie case is in the favor of plaintiff. Second, if injunction is not issued, it shall cause irreparable loss. Third is palace of convenience lies in the favor of plaintiff. If these three conditions are fulfilled, then this temporary injunction can be granted. So these were the four differences between these two type of injunctions. Now let us proceed to the Bayer Act and see what is written over there. So this is the Bayer Act of Specific Relief Act, and I am opening Chapter 7, Part 3, Section 36. Under Section 36, see here it is written preventive relief. That is, laws might not have yet taken place, but injunction may be granted if fear is reasonable, if fear is proved before the court. So, preventive relief, how granted? Here it is written at it is granted at the discretion of the court, and it may either be a temporary injunction or perpetual, that is permanent injunction. Under Section 37, both these two types of injunction have been defined. First is, I shall read it. Temporary injunctions are such as are to continue until a specific time, which has to be mentioned by the court, or until the further order of the court. It means during the pendency of the suit. And they may be granted at any stage of the suit. They are to be granted only within a suit. Independently of a suit, temporary injunction cannot be granted. And they are regulated by Code of Civil Procedure 1908. This simply means that from SRA regarding temporary injunction, we have to jump to CPC. And the relevant provision under CPC is Order 39. Order 39. In second subsection, perpetual injunction has been defined. A perpetual injunction can only be granted by way of decree, that is, after appreciating evidence made at hearing and upon merits. On merits means standard of proof in civil case has to be satisfied first. Of the suit. The defendant is thereby perpetually forever enjoined from assertion of a right or from commission of an act which would be contrary to the rights of plaintiff. So these are the two types of injunction which have been provided in Specific Relief Act. And regarding temporary injunction, we have to see the provisions of CPC. All right. Let us first do temporary injunction. So this is CPC, and I am going to open Order 39 of the code. So this is Order 39 here, temporary injunction. Now Rule 1 and Rule 2 of Order 39, they provides for grounds under which the temporary injunction in a suit can be issued. You can read these grounds. For instance, any property in dispute in a suit is in danger of being wasted, damaged or alienated by any party to the suit. The defendant threatens or intends to remove or dispose of his property with the view to defraud his creditor. C. The defendant threatens to dispossess the plaintiff or otherwise cause injury to the plaintiff. Under Rule 2, this is regarding contract, breach of contract. So if you are suing under contract for specific performance, during the pendency of the proceedings, if you think that other party may disable himself from performing the contract, or other party is going to do anticipatory breach of the contract, you can invoke this ground. All right, these grounds, they provide jurisdiction to the court that when is your application going to be maintainable. Now, if there is a case, for instance, if there is a case which does not fall in any of these grounds which have been mentioned here, but still the court thinks that injunction should be granted here, then the court will not be rendered powerless. The court can create new grounds for issuing temporary injunction by invoking its inherent powers under Section 151 CPC. So even if there is, see, this code was drafted in 1908 and now it is 2020. Transactions have completely changed. Technology, there is a huge advancement in technology now. So the courts will face new cases of new nature. Accordingly, there might be some cases before the court where need for grant of temporary injunction may arise. In such an event, the court can invoke its inherent powers to grant injunction in new cases. Now, all these grounds, satisfaction of all these grounds per se, or invocation of inherent powers per se, shall not, empower the court to grant temporary injunction. I already told you that temporary injunction, grant of temporary injunction is a discretionary power. So these grounds, they merely enable the jurisdiction of the court to grant temporary injunction. These grounds or invocation of this power, inherent power, it enables this discretionary power. Further, this discretionary power has to be judicially exercised. For this, the Supreme Court, it has time and again, in many cases, not in one, not just in one, it has in many cases formulated these principles. Let us see those principles first. After the court has enabled itself for grant of temporary injunction, it has to exercise its discretionary power judicially. Now, it has to satisfy this three-wing test. First is, first is that prima facie case must be in the favor of plaintiff. Now, this does not mean that court has to appreciate evidence. Prima facie case has to be distinguished from prima facie title. This is not prima facie title. That shall be the stage of appreciation of evidence, and that is done in trial. Here we are checking the grant of temporary injunction. Prima facie case means plaintiff has made out a case, a prima facie case to go to trial. That is, he has raised seriously, fairly arguable questions. And these questions can become subject matter of a trial. The court thinks that these questions, they require adjudication. All right, this is a triable matter. Now here, prima facie has nothing to do with the evidence. It has nothing to do with the proof of plaintiff's evidence or proof of plaintiff's title. All right, it simply means that prima facie case in favor of plaintiff means that plaintiff is able to raise a seriously arguable question which court thinks can that it can be a subject matter of trial, that this case is tribal in nature. Hence, it thinks, court thinks, till the time this question is not tried, the property of the suit or subject matter of the suit must remain preserved. So to preserve the property of the suit, the court can here grant injunction, temporary injunction. So this is the first thing, that a tribal case has to be made out by the plaintiff. Second principle is that refusal to grant temporary injunction shall cause irreparable loss. Now, this, what does this mean? That if court is not going to grant temporary injunction, it shall cause an irreparable loss to the plaintiff. Irreparable loss means a loss which cannot be compensated in terms of money. But we know that almost every loss can be compensated here in terms of money. So here irreparable loss simply does not mean that here you cannot construe it in the sense that if there is some loss which can be compensated in terms of money, so this essentially is not fulfilled. This construction cannot be taken off this principle, because at the end every type of loss can be compensated in terms of money. However, irreparable here means that proportionately it cannot be compensated in terms of money. So here irreparable has nexus to the proportionate amount. Understood? Third principle is balance of convenience lies in favor of plaintiff. Balance of convenience lies in favor of plaintiff. This means that court shall weigh the possibilities. Which possibilities? The court shall firstly weigh the possibility that in case if it does not grant injunction, what is the likely outcome of it? How much mischief is going to be suffered by the party? How much loss is going to be suffered by the party? This shall be the first possibility. Second is that if it grants injunction, then how much injury is going to be faced by the other party, or how much mischief is going to be faced by the other party. So by weighing these two possibilities, by weighing these two probabilities, in case of grant of injunction or in case of denial of injunction, if court finds that more injury is likely to be caused if injunction is not granted, then the balance of convenience lies in the favor of plaintiff. Injunction should be granted. Now all these three tests, they have to be satisfied. It is not that any of these tests per se shall entitle a person for grant of temporary injunction. All these three tests, they have to be satisfied. So for granting of temporary injunction, I told you that temporary injunction, that first of all order 39 is to be visited. If your case falls within order 39, then the jurisdiction of the court shall be there. If case does not fall in order 39, then you may apply an application under order 39 read with Section 151. So either of these two cases can enable the discretionary power of the court. After the discretionary power of the court is enabled, then these three principles which I have told you, these are to be satisfied. If these are satisfied, accordingly the court can issue temporary injunction. Now, the case which you can note in which these principles were given, there are many cases, but landmark which you can note is Dalpat Kaur versus Prahlad Singh. Dalpat Kaur versus Prahlad Singh. This is the case. So we are done with temporary injunction. We have understood it completely. Now let us see what about permanent injunction. Permanent injunction, I told you, is it can be invoked only by way of filing the suit. If it is a suit, it is a civil suit. It means the standard of proof in case of civil suit has to be satisfied. Further, we can read section 38 and see what is written over there. So this is section 38. Subject to the other provisions contained in or referred to by this chapter, a perpetual injunction may be granted to plaintiff to prevent the breach of an obligation existing in his favor. It means you are saving the plaintiff's right by way of perpetual injunction, because other person is likely to commit breach of that obligation, of the corresponding obligation. So basically, by issuing perpetual injunction, by issuing that decree, you are saving a person's right. Understood? When any such obligation arises from contract, the court shall be guided by the provisions contained in Chapter 2 relating to specific performance. No problem. Subsection 3. Now, here are certain cases where the grounds of grant of perpetual injunction are provided. When the defendant invades or threatens to invade plaintiff's right to or enjoyment of property, the court may grant perpetual injunction in the following cases. Namely, where the defendant is trustee of the property. For the plaintiff, where there exists no standard for ascertaining the actual damage caused or likely to be caused by invasion. Where the invasion is such that compensation in money would not afford adequate relief. Where injunction is necessary to prevent a multiplicity of judicial proceeding. So these are certain grounds under which perpetual injunction can be granted. See here, Section 39, mandatory injunction has been provided for. Under this, by issuing mandatory injunction, which can be distinguished from prohibitory injunction. Prohibitory injunction are prohibitive in nature. They restrain a party from doing an act. But mandatory injunction, under this, court compels a party to do a positive act by issuing this injunction. But one thing has to be kept in mind, that this act, positive act, it is asked by the court to be done only to restore status quo. Only to restore status quo. That is, to restitute the earlier affairs of the matter. So this was all regarding injunctions.